This is Rob McConnell wishing each and every one of you a very, very Merry Christmas and a happy, healthy, prosperous New Year. From our home to yours, love, light, and spirituality today and every day from this day forward. Merry Christmas, everyone.
You're listening to the X-Zone Radio Show, live and around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network and X-Zone Broadcast Network. Visit our website at www.xzoneradiotv.com.
Wave goodbye. Now it seems years. I'm back in the city.
The X-Zone Radio and TV Show is largely an opinion talk show. All opinions, comments, or statements of fact expressed by Rob McConnell's guests are strictly their own and are not to be construed as those of the X-Zone Radio and TV Show or in any manner endorsed by Rob McConnell, Relmar McConnell Media Company, Talkstar Radio Network, its affiliated stations, or employees.
All Hit Radio.
Welcome to the X Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
And welcome to the X-Zone, everyone. My name is Rob McConnell, and for the next 4 hours, I'm your host and your guide as together we cross the time-space continuum to this place that I call the X-Zone. It's a place where people dare to believe and dare to be heard. It's a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. And the X-Zone comes to you Monday through Friday from 10 p.m. Eastern until 2 a.m. Eastern, where right here, live and around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network, the X-Zone Broadcast Network, and Star Cable. If you'd like to give us a call, toll-free worldwide, 1-800-610-7035. My email address is xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com. And our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. Just a quick bit of business before I get to my first guest tonight, and we're going to have a great first hour. We're going to be talking about the Knights Templar. The April edition of the X Chronicles newspaper will be released tomorrow, so if you're on our list, you get it, no problems. However, if you'd like to get a copy of the X Chronicles newspaper, no charge, we'll send it right to you. Well, actually, what we do is we send you a link, and you can read it online, or you can download it however you want to enjoy yourself, or however you want to entertain yourself. All you have to do is send an email to me, yours truly, Rob McConnell. My email address is xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. That's xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. It's a great edition, and as they always are, I'm kind of biased since I publish it, but we've already, some members of the media have already received their pre-copy, and we're getting a heck of a lot of positive feedback. So, once again, if you'd like to get your copy of the X Chronicles newspaper, send me an email, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com. And for the latest news in the Paragators TV series, www.paragators.org. My first guest tonight is Eugene Stovall, and we're going to be talking about his new book, which is entitled The Endymion Covenant. Now, did they really guard the Holy Grail? I'm talking about the Knights Templar, of course. And thanks to best-selling books such as Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code and film blockbusters like Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade, in which they are depicted as heroic guardians of the Holy Grail, the Knights Templar of the Middle Ages have long captivated the public's imagination. Now, the Knights Templar were a Christian military order formed in the 12th century partly to help defend the Holy Land from the Muslim conquest, or so it has long been accepted by scholars. Well, my guest this hour is author and historian Dr. Eugene Stovall, believes, however, that there is no evidence to support the possibility that the Knights Templar existed much earlier than is popularly believed. In fact, he says the Knights may have been active as early as the 1st century AD, at the time of the First Jewish-Roman War and the fall of the Temple in Jerusalem. It's going to be a great hour, Exo Nation. Dr. Eugene Stovall is my very special guest, and we'll be back on the other side of this commercial break. After all, this is the X-Zone, a place where people dare to believe and dare to be heard. But please, dare not lie, or else you'll... Well, you just won't be there when we come back from a commercial, that like it's happened with so many other people. Am I proud of that? Yes, I am. Because we don't want anyone to take advantage of you, the X-Zone Nation. That's what it's all about. Dare to believe, dare to be heard. I'll be back on the other side of this two-minute commercial break as we start for tonight, Thursday, April the 22nd, in the year 2010, here in the X-Zone. Don't go away. Rob McConnell here, presenting an overview for Nicholas Paul Jennings, author of a fascinating book, Amen. It presents facts revealed by Egyptologists, facts that enable us to understand why Amen is the beginning of creation of God. It provides recommendations for religious leaders of the major religions to unify their beliefs and teach the word of God, love one another. Amen informs people how mankind conceived God. It was the Egyptians that developed the concepts of a soul, a hereafter, and son of God. And finally, after the worship of many gods, they conceived the belief in one universal God, the maker of all there is. For more information, visit www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com. Back in Victorian England, a famous theologian posed a perplexing riddle.
Why are the two top personalities in the Bible tagged with the numbers 7 and 11?
Academics agree the answer is found in the stunning discovery of a hitherto secret Bible structure explained in a new book called The Genesis Grid. The discovery is so simple that preschool children could illustrate it. Certain claims are hugely controversial and may offend some, but at the X-Zone, we've studied this awesome new book and agree with one expert, and I quote,
"These discoveries appear to be beyond coincidence."
So who or what hid this wonderful pattern in the Bible, and what might they do next? Find out more, X-Zone Nation, and read reviews on www.genesisgrid.co.uk. That's
www.genesisgrid.co.uk.
They say that you're a runaround lover, though you say it isn't so. Put me down for another, I'll know, believe me, I'll know. 'Cause a night has a thousand eyes, and a thousand eyes can't help but see. If you are true to me, thousand eyes.
All right, so if the knight has a thousand eyes, that means there's 500 Knight Templars there, right, guys? Yeah, the math works out. My guest this hour is Dr. Eugene Stovall. We're going to be talking about his new book that has come out. It's called The Edumian Covenant. And Dr. Stovall, welcome back to the X-Zone. Great having you with us, Eugene.
Thank you very much, Rob. I'm delighted to be here and with your audience.
Congratulations on another great book.
Thank you.
Can you tell our listening audience a little bit about yourself and what your interest is in the Knights Templar?
Sure. I have received a PhD in political theory from UC Berkeley, the political science department, mm-hmm. and I taught at St. Mary's College in what was called the Collegiate Seminar. And what I taught, in addition to some of the other courses, were Greek and Roman and Christian medieval thought, Renaissance thought, and I dealt with a lot of political theory and philosophers.
Right.
And my interest in the Knights Templar actually began with the book Holy Blood and Holy Grail. And I was just fascinated by that treatment of the Knights Templar and the notion of the Holy Grail not being a cup but a bloodline. And I have also been involved in reading about the Freemasons and how the Freemasons developed here in this country. And, of course, there's this connection between the Freemasons and the Knights Templar, particularly now with the new revelations about the possibility of the Knights Templar having been here as early as the 1300s.
That certainly is exciting.
Yes, and my mentor, you might say, although I never met him, is Frank Yerby. He was a brilliant writer, and one of the books that he wrote was a book called Judas, My Brother. And it doesn't seem as though this would be a connection, but this was how I really saw the connections between the Knights Templar, supposedly formed in the 10th century, and their antecedents that probably occurred way back at the time of the fall of the temple.
Were the Knights Templar as popular, let's say, 20, 30 years ago as they are today with all the interest in the Da Vinci Code Indiana Jones and The Last Crusader?
Well, the Knights Templar are one of many what we call secret societies. Mm-hmm. And of course, a lot of myth surrounds these secret societies. And what the myths and the truth are has been the subject of speculation by many, many different people from different perspectives, not only from the regular academics, but from those who are more right in a more popular vein. The idea of the Knights Templar or even the Freemasons and other secret societies captured the imagination because there's many of us who believe that they are in some way responsible for the kinds of things that are happening today on a worldwide level. So I think that the popularity of the Knights Templar have been fueled by the events that we're going through now.
So tell me, Dr. Stovall, whose idea was it to put the Knights Templar together, and what was their mandate?
Well, that's I think the problematic. That's really where I'm coming from, a completely different perspective than is normal. The normal history of the Knights Templar are that right after the Pope had called for the First Crusade in about 1099, the First Crusade, the Christian Crusade, allowed the Pope to take control of Jerusalem. And there was a king of Jerusalem, a Christian king that was set up to rule Jerusalem. Now, it is said that this Christian king received a band of knights, nine knights, who said that they were sent to Jerusalem by the Pope to defend Christians who might want to go to the various holy places. And so this king of Jerusalem gave these knights a place to stay in the royal palace there in Jerusalem. However, the knights did not defend any Christians going to the holy shrines. What they did for the next 9 years was to dig in the ruins of the temple that was destroyed. It was called Herod's Temple, the one that was destroyed by the Romans. But there was Solomon's Temple that Herod's Temple was built on top of, and they were going into these ruins as well. And after some 9 years, it was rumored that these knights found this fabulous treasure, left Jerusalem, and then became so powerful as a result of this treasure that the Pope made them his own special order and sent Bernard all over Christendom announcing that the Knights Templar was a place that young nobles should go if they wanted adventure and to make their fortune. So very quickly after the Knights Templar found this treasure, according to legend, they became the most powerful military order of the day. And not only were they a powerful military order, they initiated what is can be described as the international banking system. And it was this ability for them to move monies over great distances very safely that gave the Knights Templar not only their military power, but economic power as well.
This is starting to sound like there's a connection between the Knights Templar and what a lot of people today are calling the New World Order.
One could make those connections, but I think that the connections to the New World Order is difficult because I'm still not certain that anyone can define what that New World Order is.
All right, so how do we make the connection between the Knights Templar of way back when and the present-day events that are happening around the world?
Well, what my book does, mm-hmm. the Doom and Covenant, makes the connection between the Knights Templar and that band of knights who were responsible for all of these events that occurred in the first century. That is, the destruction of Jerusalem and the looting of the temple. And my book actually mm-hmm. began as an accident. I was doing research on a book that I'm writing on ancient Egypt, and I was reviewing my Josephus, because Josephus is a person, a historian that is very well respected, is one of the few historians that is has eyewitness accounts written down about what went on during the first century. And so I was sort of reading my Josephus, and I came across this passage that said that the insurrection, the Jewish insurrection, was successful against Rome only because the insurrectionists, the zealots, the Pharisees, went and asked for the Idumeans to come and support the insurrection. They argued that if the Idumeans didn't support this insurrection, then Rome would be able to rule all over Israel. Well, this to me was just an amazing statement, because the Idumeans and the Judeans hated each other. As I said before, the Idumeans were the descendants of Esau. The Judeans were the descendants of Jacob. Jacob's 12 sons were the founders of the 12 tribes of Israel. However, Esau and Jacob reversed their roles. It should not have been Jacob who was the patriarch of the chosen people over Israel, but it should have been Esau. Esau's mother deceived Esau's father into making it appear as though Jacob was the firstborn as opposed to Esau. So obviously, with Jacob being the head of the chosen people, there was this great enmity between the Judeans and the Idumeans. the Idumeans lived in the area where now is Jordan, and they were sort of farmers, and the Judeans were these, you know, shepherds, nomads. But over this great period of time, there a lot of hate grew up between the Idumeans and the Judeans. As a matter of fact, the prophet Isaiah and the prophet Ezekiel said that it was permissible for the Judeans to go into Idumea and steal from the Idumeans, steal their crops, because, of course, that's how they fed their herds and that's how they fed themselves. Not only was it permissible for the Judeans, according to the prophets, to steal from the Idumeans, it was also permissible, according to Isaiah, for the Judeans to murder the Idumeans if they were being obstructed from stealing their crops. When Nebuchadnezzar invaded Israel and carted the Judeans off into what was called the Babylonian captivity, it was the Idumeans who were sided with the Persians.
Dr. Stovall, please stand by, sir. You and I have to take our break at the bottom of the hour. Exonation, Dr. Eugene Stovall is our very special guest. We're talking about his new book called The Idumean Covenant. It's available at his website and also find bookstores everywhere, Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and you know the routine. His website is www.eugenestovall.com. That's EugeneStovall.com. All right, I'm going to get 500 Knights Templar out here. Yeah, you got them ready? Oh, okay, let's start singing that song about the Knights having 1,000 knights. We'll be back on the other side of this commercial break. Don't go away.
It isn't so. But if you put me down for another, I'll know, believe me, I'll know. Cause a knight has 1,000 knights.
From our home to yours, this is Laura Rogers wishing all the members of the X-Zone Nation a very Merry Christmas and a happy and joyful New Year.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know.
A witch doctor's power and his ancient tribal ways cruelly collide with the force and authority of modern Africa. Africa is viewed through myriad eyes. You will never forget these characters. A young girl forced to endure a painful, cruel, and antiquated tribal custom. The sole survivor of a vicious tribal massacre. A nun who endures physical assault that compels her to question her faith. A deprived, disadvantaged schoolgirl who is infected with HIV. The translucent soul of a murdered friend. Welcome to Africa's Unfinished Symphony. While the tale of South Africa in the wake of World War II is riveting, violent, and cruel, it is also brimming with stories of kindness, compassion, and courage. Africa's Unfinished Symphony highlights commanding characters who not only bring haunting racial clashes to life, but also convey the intense conflicts that existed between archaic customs and modern influences. You will be captivated as you follow the convoluted path of Farida, of the ancients battling to become Bertha of a modern world. But are the outcomes of her struggle the best results for her and her beloved Africa? Africa's Unfinished Symphony will immerse you in historic African themes that will jolt you out of complacency and into compassion. For more information on how you can get your very own copy of Africa's Unfinished Symphony, visit www.luciaman.com. That's www.luciaman.com.
I went back to the doctors because when I needed a second opinion, and I went back and told him he was a good doctor, but he wasn't there. I got some woman in a white coat standing there. I said, "Excuse me, but who are you?" She said, "I'm a nurse practitioner." I said, You mean your practice in being a nurse? She said, no, not quite like that. No, I am a qualified nurse. I said, oh, then why do they call you a practitioner? Because you're practicing on me. I'm not sure I want that. She said, no. Nurse practitioner is allowed to give you prescriptions, help you with minor surgeries, and all that kind of thing. And I take care of you when the doc's not around. She said, we're going to become really popular. I said, well, blimey, somebody like you is going to be really popular. Let me tell you. Oh, she said, she got offended with that. So I said, sorry, I didn't mean to offend you. But now I know what a nurse practitioner is, don't I? Remember that, nurse practitioner, they're the future. Find a good one.
For more information on Alfie and Jeff Knott, visit www.navigatingthehealthcaremaze.com. That's www.navigatingthehealthcaremaze.com.
Hi, this is Ken Elliott. When I'm floating around the universe, I always try to tune in to Rob McConnell.
Hey, hold there, Kermit the Frog on Sesame Street. When I want to find out what's going on with UFOs or ghosts, I listen to the X-Zone with Rob McConnell.
This is Les Corrigan from Target Internet Development. You're listening to Rob McConnell on the X-Zone Radio Show.
This is John Hogue, Prophecy Scholar, and you're listening to Rob McConnell in the X-Zone.
Welcome to the X-Zone, a place where fact is fiction and fiction is reality. Now, here's your host, Rob McConnell.
Welcome back, everyone. My name is Rob McConnell. This is the X-Zone Radio Show on the Talkstar Radio Network, on Star Cable, and the X-Zone Broadcast Network, coming to you from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Toll-free worldwide, 1-800-610-7035. Email X-Zone at xzoneradiotv.com. On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com. And our website, www.xzoneradiotv.com. Dr. Eugene Stovall is my special guest. We're talking about his new book. It's entitled The Edumian Covenants. And what was the Edumian Covenant, Doctor?
Basically, I used the term the Edumian Covenant to signify the fact that no longer were God's people the Judeans, mm-hmm. but they were the Edumians, and that the temple that Herod built that was destroyed by the Romans in 70 AD was actually an Edumian temple. Herod and his descendants were all Edumians. And the fact that the Edumians were appointed by Rome to be kings over Israel changes the entire understanding of what actually occurred.
So let me ask you this, Doctor. How is this new revelation being, what kind of reviews is it getting from the higher places within Catholicism, Christianity, Judaism?
Oh.
Yeah.
I have not received any reviews from them. Most of my reviews have been on Amazon. I'm getting 5-star reviews, and I'm 4-star reviews and 3-star reviews. So there are people that are just beginning to get a feeling for what I am saying. I think the most important revelation is the fact that Josephus is not an accurate person to trust on these matters. And then it is important to understand what it is that he is doing and why he's doing it. And then from these understandings, we get a connection between the Knights Templar that were established in the 10th century and the Temple Guards, the Templars, who actually guarded the temple, Herod's temple, back in the first century. And it is I'm maintaining that these two groups are the same.
So tell me, and I didn't mean to cut you off, Doctor. I apologize for that. This revelation that you've come out with, how is this going to change theology as we know it?
Well, I try to stay away from theology.
But it's part of it, isn't it?
There is a lot of historical fact that impinges upon theology. Mm-hmm. I try to stay away from theology because the reality is all religions are faith-based. You believe them or you don't. And it's useless to argue facts with people who are basically have their opinions made up on the basis of faith. So I'm not trying to in any way change anyone's faith. I'm not trying to change the standards by which people believe that is the Bible.
Well, you know, I appreciate that and I respect that, sir. I sincerely do. But isn't it important that all the religions and all the other philosophies are based on the truth? And yet, isn't this bringing the truth to light?
This is bringing the truth to light. This is saying something specifically about a specific period of time and trying to bring some historical perspective on what happened.
Okay.
Now, yes, you're absolutely right. It may, in fact, have something to do with the way in which we see Christianity, but the intent is not to make any changes in Christianity.
Oh, sir, that thought didn't even cross my mind. I was just... Yeah. You see, I appreciate when people do exact work that you do. I love it when people actually dig, they find the facts, and they say, you know what? I don't mean to offend anyone, but this is what the truth is as I have found it, and it is backed up by A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. So I respect that. That's all I was trying to get to.
Well, that's great. I just don't want to, as you can imagine, be unprepared for defending something that I'm not trying to do.
Oh, just a second here. I've got a phone call I've got to take. Yes? It's the Vatican. Well, tell them I'll call them back later. I'm busy right now. Okay, let's get back on this.
The whole point here, I think I'm trying to make is that we need to, if we're looking at the historical events surrounding the Knights Templar or the legends of Arthur and the Holy Grail and all of these kinds of things, what I'm trying to do is put some historical substance to it.
Right.
And I'm saying that if you look at the Knights Templar and you look at what was called the group that set up the Knights Templar, the Priory of Zion, well, if you take the Priory of Zion, Priory is like an abbot's church or some kind of a temple. And Zion is another word for Jerusalem. So if you think about the Priory of Zion, which supposedly is the group that is responsible for running the Templars, you get, out of Priory of Zion, you get the Temple of Jerusalem. And when you look at the Temple of Jerusalem, the last Temple of Jerusalem that was destroyed in 70 A.D., you find that the Temple of Jerusalem was defended by the temple guard, or who they were called at the time, Templars. So this is a way of connecting that period of time between the first century and the 10th century to all of that is all of the other revelations that's coming out with the Da Vinci Code or Holy Blood or Holy Grail or these other, that in fact what there has been over this whole period of time, a bloodline. And this bloodline comes from Jesus Christ himself. And some may argue that he was married, others will argue that he wasn't married. But the whole idea is that there were a group of people at the time of the first century associated with the historical person known as Jesus Christ, who had a family, brothers, sisters, a wife, children, had disciples,
mm-hmm.
had friends, and they had relatives. And all of these people were being defended, according to what I put in my book, by this group known as the Templars. And their ability to escape from the destruction of Jerusalem to Masada, and then from Masada down into Leontopolis, which is in Egypt, and then finally the Romans chased them from Leontopolis over to Cyrene, across the Libya into Cyrene, at which point, interesting enough, Josephus is said to have provided these followers and disciples and apostles and family of Christ, Josephus provided them with boats, and some of them were taken to Marseille. Others were taken up to Scotland, where Joseph of Arimathea had mm-hmm. had 10 minds from the time of Pontius Pilate. So now you have a connection with the Templars and those who are saying that there was the Grail was actually the bloodline of Christ, and that all of these people were defended and made safe by this group known as the Knights Templar.
I heard a theory once that a researcher believed that the reason why the body of Christ had disappeared from the tomb was that it was actually taken by the Knights Templar.
Mm. Well, you know, that's not so far-fetched. I mean, it's not something I've heard before, mm-hmm. but it's not far-fetched when you consider the fact that one of the major persons in this entire scenario is Joseph of Arimathea.
He was a powerful man back then.
He sat in the Sanhedrin.
Yep.
He was a Sadducee. He was providing. He had 10 mines, as I said, in mm-hmm. England and Scotland. So he was responsible for providing bronze, which is nothing more than a smelting process that you need 10 to come up with the bronze. So he had ships. And he was doing trading. So he was extremely powerful, extremely wealthy. And if you investigate some of the others, there were others who were very powerful and wealthy, too, who were involved with this new Christian sect. And so when you begin to look at the Christian sect itself, many believe that these were just sort of itinerant nomads. But in reality, they were very, very powerful people. And there were powerful people behind them. When we think of Jesus Christ's birth,
mm-hmm.
we talk about the Magi.
Yes.
Now, the Magi were very powerful priests, and they belonged to the Samaritan group. They were seeking this Savior or this Redeemer, and when they found him, they assigned the person to be his constant guardian from the time of his birth to the time of his death. And so it's not not beyond imagination mm-hmm. that, in fact, the Templars who were active at that time were responsible for guarding Christ's body.
You know, it almost seems as if the Templars were the Secret Service of the day.
Well, again, they were, as far as I could tell, and my research indicates, they were the temple guards.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the head of the temple guards at the time of the insurrection, his name was Eleazar ben Simon. And Eleazar ben Simon was the son of Simon, who is variously known as Simon Peter, Simon Magus, Simon the Zealot. And so there was a connection between Simon, who was Christ's lifelong protector, and Simon's son, who was the captain of the temple guards, who later became or we're calling the Templars.
It's amazing to see the picture that emerges when you start drawing the line from dot to dot to dot to dot.
Right.
What, in your opinion, sir, is the Holy Grail?
Well, I have to agree with those commentators who consider the Holy Grail a bloodline,
mm-hmm.
and that if one were to specifically identify one person as the Grail, one would have to consider Mary Magdalene as that person, accepting at that same time that she, in fact, was the wife of Jesus Christ.
Dr. Stovall, please stand by, sir. You and I have to take our final break for this hour. Exonation, our very special guest this hour, is Dr. Eugene Stovall. We're talking about his new book, The Edumian Covenant. It's available at his website, eugenestovall.com, or amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and find bookstores everywhere. We'll be back on the other side of this break as we continue talking about the Knights Templar. Don't go away.
I'm William S. Peckham. If you enjoy a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love my novel, From Out of the Woodwork. It's the story of a young Toronto contractor, Sean Kennedy, who buys derelict homes, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. Slums just waiting to happen. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, the house fights back. Former owners unexpectedly come out of the woodwork as he starts the destruction. The apparitions come to him when he touches old books, reads hidden letters, rummages through old boxes, finds a locket or reads a discovered manuscript of a murder mystery. From Out of the Woodwork will take you from 1899 to the horror of the World Trade Center, September 11, 2001. Check out From Out of the Woodwork on my website, www.williamspeckham.com.
The new nonfiction book, Razor of Madness, is similar to cult movies like Clockwork Orange, Dragon's Tattoo, or The Other Side of Hell. Wayne Morin Jr. and Thomas Lee Howe will expose widespread and systematic deficiencies in this thought-provoking tell-all novel. Mind control rages among scholars and law schools. Human rights are ignored while thought reform and mental manipulation are accepted practices used as behavior modification. Dr. Louis Jolyon West comes to mind. Media and public scrutiny shows that United States mental hospitals are in fact destructive murder industries. Razor of Madness, expose novel, details this epidemic through an in-depth professional and personal investigation. For decades, there has been a revolving door policy that still releases killers and pedophiles back into society. The maestro of mind control continues to haunt America to this very day. Razor of Madness is available in paperback or as a downloadable ebook at Amazon.com. If you enjoy reading a good mystery with a touch of the paranormal, then you'll love From Out of the Woodwork by William S. Peckham. Sean Kennedy, a Toronto contractor, buys derelict houses, guts them, and turns them into multifamily dwellings. When Sean buys 29 Livery Lane, a century house in ruins, and starts the renovation, the house fights back. He is visited by ghosts of owner's past. His visions are triggered by touching an oak mantle, reading a faded letter, opening an old locket, or opening a brand new casket in the basement. These visions will take you on a trip across southern Ontario from Niagara Falls to Toronto to Kingston. From Out of the Woodwork is now available in paperback and on your favorite electronic reader. To order your copy of From Out of the Woodwork, go to www.williamspeckham.com. That's www.williamspeckham.com.
Eugene Stovall is my special guest. His website is www.eugenestovall.com. Eugene, what about the Knights Templar in France? What happened there?
Yeah, that's the real surprising twist that history gives to the Knights Templar. The tradition is that about 1309, some 300 years after the Knights Templar made their remarkable appearance on the world scene, the French king, Philip IV, was able to get the Pope's permission to absolutely destroy the Knights Templar. On one day, he sent out a bull that said that every Knights Templar should be arrested and imprisoned, and they tortured them. They accused them of all types of religious heresies, and from then on, the Knights Templar had to go underground. One of the interesting issues about this, however, is that very seldom do the historians remark that the King of France had kidnapped the Pope prior to his attack against the Knights Templar. In many of the descriptions, they talk about the Pope being in collusion with the King of France against the Knights Templar. But in fact, the King of France, Philip IV, had actually kidnapped the Pope, taking him to what was called Avignon, and for the next 70 years or more, seven popes were actually held in prison at Avignon and were forced to serve the French king's wishes. So that it's not always, you know, we hear about the Knights Templar being destroyed by the Pope, but the reality is that the Pope had little to do with what the King of France did to the Knights Templar, because the Pope himself was a
victim,
being incarcerated.
So why did the King of France kidnap the Pope?
Well, it had to do with, I think, with power of the religion over the masses. I mean, it was military power, and there are some today that don't understand this. Military power has its limitations. In a real sense, the power of the word or the power of
the people,
gospel,
yeah,
is much more effective. And so I think Philip of France realized that, and he wanted to rule over Europe, and he realized that getting the Pope in his hands and making the Pope make pronouncements that benefited France was the best way to do it.
Eugene, I want to thank you so much for joining us. Continued success, and I look
thank
forward
so
to
much,
the next
Rob.
Time we join each other back here in the X-Zone. Take care, my friend.
You do the same.
I will,
bye-bye,
sir. Dr. Eugene Stovall has been our guest this hour. www.eugenestovall.com. He's the author of The Edumian Covenant. It's available online at Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and fine bookstores everywhere. I'll be back after the news. Don't go away.